This is the last part of the Synnet D587. This model was from 1973 and was also sold in the United States with the same model number. There was a higher end version with an 8-track deck here on the side and an FM stereo tuner. This is on the mono. And we're gonna first, we replace the rectifier dials, which one was broken, and we had a death channel that was due to this connector here that was very dirty, and also cleaning and relocation the port helped a little bit. Then we have this cable that goes to the headphone jack on the back that was loose and making poor contact. Moving to the tuner section, IM was working fine and still it is, but FM was very distorted. I've changed the capacitors and it seems to help, but it really don't. On one station it's not distorted, but on the rest it still is, and I don't know why. I think there is an alignment problem, because when you go to a station there's the with double hum when it goes louder, then it goes quieter, and then louder again. And also the AFC does not work. When you put it on, it goes to a different station. The sensitivity is good, but the selectivity is very poor. There's a station that appears 2 or 3 times on the dial, so I think it is an alignment problem, and all the alignment points are filled with wax, so there's nothing we can do about that. And even if there weren't, I don't have the equipment nor the experience to fix it. So that's okay, I can fix it, but it's going to a room with a 2 radio, so I'm gonna never use the tuner anyway. But I would like to see it working. I have found a bad transistor here on the FM front end. But changing it did nothing. Our RF-amp is working, oscillator is working, but it's just very distorted and with poor selectivity. So I let you see now, I'm gonna turn it on. And I've changed the dial bulbs with LEDs. That's why it's blue now. With the incandescent bulbs was a horrible greenish tint that I didn't like at all, so I went with LEDs. I'll show you then how I do it. So this is AM, still works fine. Very sensitive and works really well. But when we go to FM, so now we're on FM, and some stations doesn't sound too bad. But this is our classical station that is very strong, and as you see, it's very, very distorted. And when I go to IFC, it does not even go to another station, just go to, I don't know. So FM is not working at all. And I really think it's an alignment issue, but I'm not 100% sure, so I'm gonna leave it as it is for now. For the LEDs, I just took the original light bulbs and broke it, and soldered the new LED in. So no permanent modification. The only thing else I had to do was wire the in series, and of course I have to put a full wave rectifier here. And CNET was nice enough to put us a nice terminal strip here, so it was pretty easy. And the transformer outputs 7.5 volts, and the LED can drop 4.3 each, so I didn't need to put a resistor in series. And the brightness is okay as it is, so I'm gonna leave it. So this is how it looks with the blue LEDs. Really cool, I like that blue a lot. The green was really awful. And the last problem was one of those little transistors there. One of them was noisy and I had to replace it. I'm gonna replace both just to be safe, but and that one was the one that was bad. Still checks okay, but it's noisy. I'm gonna put the bad one in and I try to show you. So right now I'm in phono and I put the bad transistor in. I'm gonna let you see. So I put the bad transistor in and you can hear all the noise and the static, and the rest of the electrolytic capacitors all check perfect, no leakage, low ESR and right on the money. So I'm not gonna change them. On the phonograph I've replaced the original 2G cartridge that had the suspension gone with this Pampa. And the way I did it was cutting the rear of the original and gluing it to the Pampa. So the Pampa is not hot glued directly to the head shell. So if it ever needs replacement, you can replace it. If you wanna go back to the original CNET cartridge, you can unplug this and put the CNET right in and it will fit just fine. I also cut the rod of the original stylus and glue it to the cartridge too, so it has the blue thingy on the top like the original, and I think it turned out pretty good. That's the way I like to do the modifications. Not permanent, so you can always go back to the original design if you so decide it. The mechanism and the motor have been cleaned and relubricated, and now it's all turning free. And the other thing that I've done is this part here was very rusty and the paint was coming off, so I sanded it off and put a new coat of paint. This is a very thick coat, so it's not going away by the using. It's not perfect because the only way to get it perfect was just to remove all the strip it through bare metal and repaint the whole thing, which I'm not gonna do because it's a lot of work and I don't really know how to do it. So anyway, this is ready and we're gonna play some records. Other thing to notice is this Pampa cartridge came with a flip needle, but it has two LP tips, even though this size says 78. So if you're gonna play 78, you really want to get the right needle to it, which is very easy to find. There's a ton of them old stock and they are still being made, so that's a really cool thing about this cartridge, because it came with a 45 adapter. And I'm gonna use it to play my RCA box sets. So this is gonna be perfect for it. And they are not in very good shape to begin with, so less than 5 grams won't hold them any further. I've tried different tracking forces, and this thing tracks well above 3 grams.
If you love me half as much as I love you, you wouldn't want.
And just to show you now, we are down to 3 grams instead of 4.8. I'll let you hear the difference.
Eyes that bind your love outside my heart, I never let you cross my mind except when we're apart.
Still tracking well at only 3 grams, so probably I could leave it here, but as I said, I'd rather go higher than lower if I'm not sure. These 45 bar sets are really cool, but they were never sold outside the US or Canada, so if you want to buy them, you have to import them from the US, and they are really expensive because you have to pay like $20 just shipping. So if you are from the US, you are really lucky because you can get these records really cheap over there. So here we go. Don't really like these spindles with the overarm thing, they are a pain. Dual and Philips made record changers without the overarm, they are much easier to use and you don't risk scratching the records with the overarm. This is one of the reasons why this was never a success, because if you like classical music, you have like a ton of stops between tracks, between records. But as you can see, it works just fine and sounds pretty good. So I accidentally broke one of the ceramic rods on the cartridge and I had to install a new one, but since this one was broken, I decided to take a look inside, and you can see the two ceramic rods there and the yoke where the stylus rests on. So when the stylus vibrates, it moves the ceramic rod here, and the ceramic, when gets bent, it produces a voltage between the top and the bottom, and that's where the contacts are attached to. So that's how a ceramic stereo cartridge works. We have the two for the one for the left and one for the right channel. So very simple, but very clever at the same time. So now I have to install a new one. And that's why I don't like to glue the cartridge directly to the head shell, because when the time comes to replace it, You can't. You will need to find a new tonal or a new head shell at least. I don't like that. If I had glued this card side, now I'd be screwed because there's no way to remove it when it's done. So is it, the best thing to do is find a way to mount it without the gluing directly to the head shell.
Shout.